I am Professor Guna Magesan from New Zealand. I am a volunteer of Hindu Economic Forum. In many of the conferences, my job is to introduce the MC, the master of ceremony. It is the master of ceremony who makes a lot of, not only the entertainment, they make sure things go as per plan. I'm sorry that we are starting about half an hour late, but when the minister comes, he can be part of this. We are starting the program. Srimati Kanti Shastri, she has hosted around 2000 episodes for ETV, Ma, Gemini TV, HMTV, for programs in music, news, with two spiritual gurus doing translations and voice-based programs. She is also into spiritual narrations. I welcome Srimati Kanti Shastri. Let's give you a big applause for her. Thank you.
Andariki namaskaram. Thank you, Sri Guna Maheshanji. I welcome you all to this great place called Vijayawada, full of history. ఈ చారిత్రాత్మక నగరానికి మీ అందరికీ కూడా స్వాగత సుమాంజలి. హిందువుల గురించి ఇప్పుడే మనం ఒక వీడియో చూసాం. హిందూస్ నీడ్ నాట్ బి ఇంట్రడ్యూస్డ్ యాజ్ హిందూయిజం ఇస్ ఎ ధర్మ అండ్ విత్ ద ఏబుల్ గైడెన్స్ ఆఫ్ స్వామీజీ ద రీజనల్ హిందూ ఎకనామిక్ ఫోరమ్స్ మీటింగ్ ఫర్ గవర్నమెంట్ ఐఎమ్ సారీ ఫర్ తెలంగాణ అండ్ ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్ is being held in Vijayawada. And I once again welcome you all to this place called Vijayawada. And firstly, I welcome all the dignitaries present. When they come on to the stage, I'll be briefing you about their achievements and how great they are. We are really, really happy to have you all, sir, here. Andariki marokkasari swagatham cheptu. ఈనాటి కార్యక్రమంలో కొన్ని హౌస్ రూల్స్ అనేవి చెప్పబడుతున్నాయి. ముఖ్యంగా అందరూ కూడా ఫైర్ అలాగే ఏదైనా ప్రమాదం జరిగినప్పుడు హోటల్ వారు అందించేటువంటి ఇమీడియట్ ఎమర్జెన్సీ హెల్ప్ని తీసుకోవాల్సిందిగా మేము కోరుతున్నాము. అండ్ ఐ ఆల్సో రిక్వెస్ట్ ఎవ్రీబడి టు కీప్ దేర్ మొబైల్స్ ఇన్ సైలెన్స్. హౌస్ రూల్స్. వెన్ ఎ మీటింగ్ ఆర్ పార్ట్ there is held under the house rule, participants are free to use the information received, but neither the identity nor the affiliation of the speaker or speakers to be revealed outside. It is chala important. And everyone is free to talk anything. Your version can be spoken in this hall itself, but nothing should go out anedi oka mukhyamainatuvanti rule anamata, house rule. The Chatham House Rule is intended to promote public discussion of the views expressed at a meeting, but without attributing these views to any individual or organization. Mukhyanga oka karyakramam erpaatu chesukunnappudu mana aa rules regulations anni kuda mana ee hall lone evaru edaina kuda maatladetuvanti freedom icharu. So that is what they asked me to read this house rules anevi. Aa tarvata mana mana sabha karyakramalloki velipodam. మనకి మన హిందూ సంప్రదాయంలో దీపం జ్యోతి పరబ్రహ్మ దీపారాధనతో దీప ప్రకాశనంతోనే ఏ కార్యక్రమం ప్రారంభమవుతుంది కాబట్టి పెద్దలందరినీ దీప ప్రకాశనానికి రావాల్సిందిగా కోరుతున్నాను. ఐ రిక్వెస్ట్ ఆల్ ద డిగ్నిటరీస్ టు ప్లీజ్ కమ్ అండ్ లైట్ ద ల్యాంప్. స్వామీజీ ఈజ్ ద మెయిన్ పర్సన్. స్వామి విజ్ఞానందజీ వారి గైడెన్స్లో ఇతర పెద్దలందరూ కూడాను శ్రీ మల్లికార్జునరావు గారు శ్రీ శ్యామ్ ఎస్కే డే గారు Sri Han Nagavan, Sri S. N. Kumar Buddhavarpugaru, Sri Murali Krishna Muttavarpugaru, Gokaraj Gangaraj Garu, Sri Rajendra Prasad Garu, Sri D. S. N. Murthy Garu.
వక్రతుండ మహాకాయ కోటి సూర్య సమప్రభా నిర్విఘ్నం కురు మే దేవ సర్వకార్యేషు సర్వదా. వక్రతుండ మహాకాయ కోటి సూర్య సమప్రభా నిర్విఘ్నం కురు మే దేవ సర్వకార్యేషు సర్వదా. సర్వకార్యేషు సర్వదా.
ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్ ప్రభుత్వం విద్యాశాఖ మంత్రి శ్రీ ఆదిమూలపు సురేష్ గారికి స్వాగత సుమాంజలి. ఎ వార్మ్ వెల్కమ్ టు ద మినిస్టర్ ఫర్ ద ఎడ్యుకేషన్ గవర్నమెంట్ ఆఫ్ ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్ శ్రీ ఆదిమూలపు సురేష్ గారు. మే ఐ నౌ కాల్ అపాన్ అవర్ ఆనరబుల్ గెస్ట్ టుడే ఆన్ టు ద డైస్. శ్రీ ఆదిమూలపు సురేష్ గారు, మినిస్టర్ ఫర్ ఎడ్యుకేషన్ గవర్నమెంట్ ఆఫ్ ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్, వారిని సవినయంగా వేదిక మీదకి ఆహ్వానిస్తున్నాను. స్వామి విజ్ఞానంద్జీ, ఫౌండర్ వరల్డ్ హిందూ ఎకనామిక్ ఫోరం, వారిని కూడా సవినయంగా వేదిక మీదకి ఆహ్వానిస్తున్నాను. చప్పట్లు కొడితే బాగుంటుంది. శ్రీ శామ్ ఎస్కే డే గారు, సిఇఓ నార్త్ స్టార్ అన్లిమిటెడ్ ఇంక్ యుఎస్ఏ. శ్రీ ఎస్ఎన్ కుమార్ బుద్ధవరపు గారు, చైర్పర్సన్ హిందూ ఎకనామిక్ ఫోరం 2020 విజయవాడ ఆర్గనైజింగ్ కమిటీ, వారిని కూడా సవినీగా వేదిక మీదకు ఆహ్వానిస్తున్నారు. శ్రీ మురళీకృష్ణ ముత్తవరపు, ప్రెసిడెంట్ హిందూ ఎకనామిక్ ఫోరం ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్ చాప్టర్, వారిని కూడా సవినీగా వేదిక మీదకు ఆహ్వానిస్తున్నాను. శ్రీ హేన్ లాగవెన్, వారిని కూడా సవినయంగా వేదిక మీద ఆహ్వానిస్తున్నాను. ఐ రిక్వెస్ట్ యూ సార్ టు ప్లీజ్ టేక్ యువర్ సీట్ ఆన్ ద డయస్. శ్రీ గోకరాజు గంగరాజు గారు, ఫార్మర్ ఎంపీ అండ్ చైర్మన్ లైలా గ్రూప్, వారిని కూడా వేదిక మీదకి ఆహ్వానిస్తున్నాను. శ్రీ సి రాజేంద్ర ప్రసాద్ గారు, సిఇఓ కాంటినెంటల్ కాఫీ, వారిని కూడా సవినయంగా వేదిక మీద ఆహ్వానిస్తున్నాను. శ్రీ డిఎస్ఎన్ మూర్తి గారు, వైస్ ప్రెసిడెంట్ హిందూ ఎకనామిక్ ఫోరం హైదరాబాద్ చాప్టర్, వారిని కూడా వేదిక మీదకు ఆహ్వానిస్తున్నాను. ఇక ఈనాటి వెల్కమ్ అడ్రస్, స్వాగత ఉపన్యాసాన్ని ఇవ్వవలసిందిగా శ్రీ ఎస్ఎన్ కుమార్ బుద్ధవరపు, చైర్మన్ హిందూ ఎకనామిక్ ఫోరం 2020 విజయవాడ ఆర్గనైజింగ్ కమిటీ, వారిని కోరుతున్నాను. ముందుగా వారి గురించి Mr. S. N. Kumar Budhavarapu has been appointed as the chairman of the Board of Farmlands of Africa Incorporation. He has served since 2010 as the chairman and MD of Budhavarapu Farms South Africa, a Republic of Ghana agricultural production company with presence in West Africa. He is a shareholder of AB Distilleries Limited since 2007, director of Object One Information Systems Limited since 2006, and partner at PB Agencies AP JIL, Marketing and SVM Power Hyderabad since 2007 and 2004 respectively. From 2001 to 2005, he was a partner in Satya Telecom Hyderabad, India. He is also the honorary consulate of the Republic of Guinea in Hyderabad for AP and Telangana. With a round of applause, I request Sri Kumar Garu to deliver the welcome address.
వేదికలో ఇచ్చిన పెద్దలందరికీ, డబ్ల్యూ హిందూ ఎకనమిక్ ఫోరం డెలిగేట్స్కి, కార్యకర్తలకి, అందరికీ ఇదే నా స్వాగతం. బేసిక్గా ఈ కార్యక్రమాన్ని 2014 నుంచి ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్ తెలంగాణలో హైదరాబాద్ చాప్టర్ ద్వారా చేయడం జరిగింది. ఫస్ట్ టైం రాష్ట్రాలు రెండు విడిపోయినాక తెలుగు రాష్ట్రాలు విజయవాడ చాప్టర్ ఈరోజు లాంచ్ చేయవలసి జరుగుతుంది. మన మురళి గారు టేకప్ చేస్తున్నారు, స్వామీజీ అనౌన్స్ చేస్తారు తొందరలోనే. బేసిక్గా రేపు 5 సెషన్స్ ఏర్పాటు చేయడం జరిగింది. మన సాంప్రదాయిక వ్యవసాయ రాష్ట్రం కాబట్టి మనం ఆహారాన్ని దిగుమతి చేసే స్టేజ్ నుంచి ఎగుమతి చేసే స్టేజ్కి వచ్చి మళ్ళీ దిగుమతి చేసుకునే పరిస్థితి రావడం వల్ల నీరు భూమి సరైన రీతిలో వినియోగించుకోకపోవడం వల్ల కార్గో పోర్ట్ ఫెసిలిటీస్ సరిగ్గా లేకపోవడం వల్ల ఎగపోతులు జరిగిపోతున్నాయి. దాని గురించి రేపు డిస్కస్ చేద్దాం. అలాగే ఫుడ్ ప్రాసెసింగ్లో ఎన్నో రకాల ఆపర్చునిటీస్ ఉన్నాయి. వాటిన్నిటి గురించి రేపు డీటెయిల్గా డిస్కస్ చేయడానికి ప్యానల్ ఎక్స్పర్ట్స్ అందరూ వచ్చున్నారు. ఆ టెక్నాలజీని మనం నెదర్లాండ్స్, ఇజ్రాయెల్, థాయిలాండ్, ఇలాంటి కంట్రీస్ నుంచి తీసుకోవడానికి కూడా మనకి ఆ దేశాల నుంచి మన హిందూ మిత్రులందరూ ఇచ్చేశారు. అలాగే నేను ఆనరీ కౌన్సిల్ ఫర్ రిపబ్లిక్ ఆఫ్ గినీ వెస్ట్ ఆఫ్రికా. ఆఫ్రికాలో దాదాపు 12 సంవత్సరాలు బట్టి మేము అక్కడ ఆఫ్రికాలో రకరకాల వ్యాపారాలు చేస్తున్నాం. మన ఫెలో హిందూ ఎంటర్ప్రినర్స్ అందరికీ నా రిక్వెస్ట్ ఏంటంటే, ఆఫ్రికాలో దేర్ ఆర్ లాట్ ఆఫ్ ఆపర్చునిటీస్, ఎస్పెషల్లీ ఇన్ అగ్రికల్చర్, మెడిసినల్ ఫీల్డ్, హాస్పిటల్ హెల్త్ కేర్, పౌల్ట్రీ, ఫిషరీస్, మైనింగ్, ఎన్నో రకాల అవకాశాలు ఉన్నాయి. మనం అందరం ఆఫ్రికా వైపు దృష్టి సారించకపోవడం వల్ల చైనీస్ అందరూ వచ్చి మైనింగ్లో ఆల్మోస్ట్ 90% ఆఫ్ మైన్స్ దే ఆల్రెడీ ఆక్యుపైడ్. ఇదే విషయం చైనీస్ మన మలేషియా, సింగపూర్లో కూడా ఇలాగే జరిగింది. మనకి అలాంటివి జరగకుండా చూసుకోవాలంటే మనందరం కూడా ఆఫ్రికా మీద దృష్టి పెట్టాల్సిన అవసరం కూడా ఉంది. ఒక చిన్న ఎగ్జాంపుల్ చెప్తాను. మనం పక్కనున్న శ్రీలంక దాదాపు ఒక 8,000 కోట్ల రూపాయల మిల్క్ పౌడర్ ఇంపోర్ట్ చేసుకుంటారు నెదర్లాండ్స్, ఆస్ట్రేలియా నుంచి. మనం ఇక్కడ ఎక్సెస్ మిల్క్ పౌడర్ ప్రొడక్షన్ ఉంది, మనం చేయలేకపోతున్నాం. ఇలాంటి ఇష్యూస్ అన్నింటినీ మన రాయల్ హిందూ ఎకనమిక్ ఫోరం శ్రీలంకలో కూడా చాలా యాక్టివ్గా ఉన్నారు. మన వాళ్ళు ఎవరైనా ఇంట్రెస్టెడ్ ఉంటే మనం బ్రాంచ్తో కాంటాక్ట్ చేసుకుని ఆ ఎక్స్పోర్ట్ ఆర్డర్స్ పరిశీలించవచ్చు. ఇలాంటి వాటిలన్నింటినీ డిస్కస్ చేయడానికనే స్వామీజీ ఇది చేశారు. అలాగే చైనా నుంచి కూడా మిత్రులు రావడం జరిగింది మన వరల్డ్ హిందూ ఎకనమిక్ ఫోరం నుంచి. వాళ్ళు కూడా రేపు చాలా ఆపర్చునిటీస్ ఇస్తున్నారు. ఎన్నో రకాల ప్రోడక్ట్స్ మనం ఇక్కడ చేయగలిగి ఉండి కూడా చేయకుండా ఇంపోర్ట్ చేసుకుంటున్నాం. ఇక సెల్ ఫోన్ ప్లాస్టిక్ కవర్స్ దాదాపు 3 నుంచి 4,000 కోట్ల రూపాయలు మనం చైనా నుంచి ఇంపోర్ట్ చేసుకుంటున్నాం. ఇది చాలా ఇన్సల్ట్ మనకి. ఎందుకంటే ప్లాస్టిక్ ఇక్కడ దొరుకుతుంది, స్కిల్ వర్కర్స్ ఉన్నారు, అందరూ ఉన్నారు, అయినా కూడా మనం చేస్తున్నాం అంటే అంతేత. ఇలాంటి ప్రోడక్ట్స్ ఒక 3,000 ప్రోడక్ట్స్ ఆయన ఐడెంటిఫై చేశారు. ఇక్కడ మనకి రా మెటీరియల్ ఉండి, మార్కెట్ ఉండి, బైబ్యాక్ ఆర్డర్స్ తోటి రేపు కూడా దాని గురించి డిస్కస్ చేయడం జరుగుతుంది. ఇక్కడే ఇదే హాల్లో ఎంతోమంది అవకాశాలు, ఎన్నో రకాల ఆపర్చునిటీస్ ఇక్కడనే ఉన్నాయి. హెచ్సిఎఫ్ అన్నది ఇది ఒక్కరిది కాదు, మనందరిది. ఈ హాల్లో ఉన్న మిత్రులందరికీ అనే విజ్ఞప్తి, ఇది స్వామీజీ 65 దేశాల్లో దాదాపు ఎస్టాబ్లిష్ చేశారు. ఎన్నో వేల మంది బిజినెస్ పీపుల్ ఇంట్లో మెంబర్స్ కింద ఉన్నారు. దీనిలో ఉన్న అడ్వాంటేజ్ ఏంటని చాలామంది అడుగుతుంటే చెప్తున్నాను. ఇవాళ గోపి గారు జర్మనీ నుంచి వచ్చారు. ఆఫ్రికాలో, యూరోప్లో ఎవరన్నా కంపెనీ స్టార్ట్ చేసి ఆపరేషన్ స్టార్ట్ చేయాలంటే గోపి గారిని ఇక్కడే కాంటాక్ట్ చేయొచ్చు. ఇంట్రడ్యూస్ మిస్టర్ గోపి ఫ్రమ్ జర్మనీ. గోపిగారు అలాగే స్టార్ట్అప్ హిందూ ఆర్గనైజేషన్ మన నవంబర్ 25th జర్మనీలో లాంచ్ చేశారు. అలాగే రీజనల్ కాన్ఫరెన్స్ తోటి ఆయన కూడా స్టార్టప్స్కి ఫండింగ్ చేయడానికి అన్ని రకాల ఆప్షన్స్ ఉన్నాయి. ఆ వెబ్ అప్లికేషన్ మీరు డౌన్లోడ్ చేసుకుని ఎవరంటే వాళ్ళు దాన్ని ఇంప్లిమెంట్ చేయించవచ్చు. మనకి ఏదైనా చేయగలిగే శక్తి ఉంది. 100 కోట్ల మంది హిందూ సోదరులందరూ మన వెనకాల ఉన్న ధైర్యంతో మనం ముందడుగు వేసి మన దేశాన్ని మోడీ గారు కలకి అనుకున్నట్టుగా 5 ట్రిలియన్ ఎకానమీకి తీసుకెళ్లే జరిగే రోజు అతి దగ్గరలోనే ఉందని అనుకుంటున్నాం. మన పూర్వీకులు సాధించారు. అప్పుడు దాదాపు 400 సంవత్సరాల క్రితం మన జీడిపి ఆల్మోస్ట్ ఆసియన్ జీడిపి వచ్చి 49% ఉంటే మన ఇండియన్ జీడిపి అనేది 35% ఉంది. అది దాదాపు 200-300 సంవత్సరాల నుంచి 2% తగ్గింది. ప్రపంచ జనాభాలో మన వాటా 16% కాబట్టి మన జీడిపి కనీసం 16% వెళ్ళాలని స్వామీజీ ఆకాంక్ష. సో దానికి స్వామీజీ ఆశీస్సులు ఎప్పుడు ఉంటాయి. ఈ ఫోరమ్ మనకు అండగా ఉంటుంది. ఆ వైపు అడుగులు వేయాలని అందరినీ కోరుకుంటున్నాను. ఇకపోతే వరల్డ్ హిందూ ఎకనమిక్ ఫోరం స్వామీ చాలా రోజులు పెట్టి ఆలోచించి 2011 హాంకాంగ్లో స్టార్ట్ చేశారు. తర్వాత బ్యాంకాక్లో, తర్వాత లండన్లో, తర్వాత లాస్ ఏంజల్స్లో, చికాగోలో, ఇలాగ అన్ని చోట్ల చేసుకుంటూ వస్తున్నారు. ఈ సంవత్సరం ఇట్స్ హ్యాపెనింగ్ ఇన్ నెదర్లాండ్స్. స్వామీజీ ఐఐటి చదువుకుని మనందరం బాగుపడాలని సత్సంకల్పతోటి స్వామివారు పరిపెట్టిన ఈ కార్యక్రమానికి మనందరం చేదుడుబాదుడిగా ఉండి ఆయన సత్సంకల్పం నెరవేర్చాలని కోరుకుందాం. నూతనంగా ఏర్పడిన మన రాష్ట్రంలో అద్భుతమైన శక్తి ఉంది. అదేంటంటే ఇండియాలో చాలా రాష్ట్రాల్లో లేని శక్తి ఎంటర్ప్రినర్షిప్. మన వాళ్ళందరూ కూడా చాలా ఎంటర్ప్రినర్షిప్ ఉన్నవాళ్ళు. ఏ దేశమైనా, ఏ ప్రపంచంలో, ఏ మూలకన్నా వెళ్ళి వ్యాపారం చేసే శక్తి మన దగ్గర ఉంది, నాలెడ్జ్ మన దగ్గర ఉంది. సో అంచేత డాక్టర్లు ఇంజనీర్ని తయారు చేయడం కాకుండా ఎంటర్ప్రినర్స్ని డెవలప్ చేయవలసిన అవసరం మన సొసైటీ మీద ఉంది. కాబట్టి ఐ రిక్వెస్ట్ స్వామీజీ టు సెటప్ వన్ ఎంటర్ప్రినర్షిప్ యూనివర్సిటీ విత్ ద హెల్ప్ ఆఫ్ గవర్నమెంట్ ఇన్ ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్, సో దట్ ద వరల్డ్ హిందూ ఎకనమిక్ ఫోరం క్యాన్ టేకప్ ద జాబ్. రాబోయే 5 సంవత్సరాల్లో తెలుగు రాష్ట్రాల్లో అన్ని టౌన్స్లోనూ ఈ వరల్డ్ హిందూ ఎకనమిక్ ఫోరం, హిందూ ఎకనమిక్ ఫోరం అన్ని టౌన్స్లను స్టార్ట్ చేసి ముందు మనలో మనమే కోఆపరేట్ చేసుకుంటూ బిజినెస్ డెవలప్ చేసుకుని ముందుకెళ్దామని, అలాగే రేపు నెదర్లాండ్స్లో 2020 నెదర్లాండ్స్ జూలైలో జరిగే సమావేశానికి మనందరం ప్రతినిధి బృందంగా వెళ్ళి మిగతా ప్రపంచంలో 60-40 దేశాల నుంచి అందరూ వచ్చే మిత్రులతో మనం బిజినెస్ ఒప్పందాలు కానీ, టెక్నాలజీ ట్రాన్స్ఫర్స్ కానీ, ఫండింగ్ కానీ, ఎనీ ఆప్షన్స్ మనం ఎక్స్ప్లోర్ చేసుకోవచ్చు. అవన్నీ రేపు మనం డీటెయిల్గా 5 ఫోరమ్స్లో డిస్కస్ చేద్దాం. థ్యాంక్ యూ వెరీ మచ్.
ధన్యవాదాలు సార్. తర్వాత ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్ ప్రభుత్వం విద్యాశాఖ మంత్రులు శ్రీ ఆదిమూలపు సురేష్ గారిని ప్రసంగించవలసిందిగా కోరుతున్నాను. ఐ నౌ రిక్వెస్ట్ మినిస్టర్ ఫర్ ఎడ్యుకేషన్ గవర్నమెంట్ ఆఫ్ ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్ శ్రీ ఆదిమూలపు సురేష్ గారు టు సే ఫ్యూ వర్డ్స్ అబౌట్ హిమ్. డాక్టర్ సురేష్ ఈజ్ అ సివిల్ సర్వెంట్ టర్న్ పొలిటీషియన్ అండ్ ఈజ్ ద మినిస్టర్ ఆఫ్ ఎడ్యుకేషన్ గవర్నమెంట్ ఆఫ్ ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్. Mr. Suresh did his bachelor's degree in civil engineering from NIT Suratkal and then doctorate in computer science in engineering. He started his political career in the year 2009 by quitting his designation as civil servant from Indian Railways and joined in the politics. He was the member of Legislative Assembly for Erragondapalem constituency. Later he was elected as member of Legislative Assembly for the Santanuthalpadu constituency. Right now he is our Education Minister. With a big round of applause, please welcome Suresh Gar.
At the outset, I offer my salutations to the lotus feet of our Swami Vidyanandji and distinguished delegates who have come from various parts of the country and outside the country, and all the dignitaries on the dais, Professor Malkajan Rao Garu, Mr. Hain Legwin, Sri Sam Garu, Sri Murli Krishna Garu, Sri Gokaraju Gangaraj Garu, and Sri Rajendra Prasad Garu, and Sri DSM Murthy Garu, press and print media, and ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening to you. I bring my greetings to all of you on behalf of the Education Department of Government of Andhra Pradesh. I really very much thankful to you and to all the organizers for giving me this wonderful opportunity of interacting with all the delegates and then say a few words about the various state initiatives that are being taken up in Andhra Pradesh under the dynamic leadership of our Chief Minister Sri Y.S. Jagan Mohan Reddy Garu. In fact, first of all, I am very much impressed about the very concept of this initiative, which is really giving a good platform for all the elements in the Hindu society, the technocrats, the bankers, the industrialists, the entrepreneurs, the educationists, so that they can share their expertise, experience, knowledge, resources, so that we can help each other and then create some surplus wealth and then thereby share the wealth of the society. So really, I appreciate the very concept and the great idea of Swami Vignananji. Really, very, we really appreciate that. And then in education in Andhra Pradesh also, we are committed to giving value-based, quality-based education to the people of Andhra Pradesh. We have taken up a lot of initiatives. The basic problems of education we are addressing. In fact, we would like to address them very, very strongly. The basic problems of the world, the poverty, the hunger, and illiteracy. These are the problems which we are forcing, and we foresee with the educational ecosystem. As you know, the poverty in learning, we have a lot of poverty in learning. The basic problem here is not unemployment, the problem is unemployability, lack of skills, lack of knowledge. As a child, we have been asked to show higher grades and to get higher grades, not gain higher knowledge. When you go for employment, we have been asked to show your grades again or your ranks, not the skills. So here in Andhra Pradesh, our Honorable Chief Minister, we have taken a lot of initiatives to make education which has equity, affordability, accessibility, and quality and accountability. So I'm sure we are very, very fortunate to have this initiative convention, regional convention in Andhra Pradesh, and of having trusts in Andhra Pradesh and conducting this regional conference for both Andhra Pradesh and Telangana here. And we promise you that from education department, we are definitely committed to give you a quality and skilled manpower in whichever field you want to start off your industries or your entrepreneurship or the areas of your choice. You will definitely get a good human resources which are really qualitatively, ethically, and then value-based manpower here. And then we in Andhra Pradesh, we are looking for an education which will give empowerment, which will give quality to the students. So tomorrow again, I've been asked to participate in one of the conclaves, I think one of the panel discussions on leadership and then education policy. I think we'll be sharing more thoughts on that. It will be suffice here to just mention that we are here to really give one hand holding to all the entrepreneurs and all the best of the elements in the Hindu society who are willing to start off whatever business they want in Andhra Pradesh. We are here to commit for, we are committed to give you a good human resources in all your things. Thank you so much for giving this wonderful opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. May I now request Sri Hein Lagavin, who had come from Netherlands to Vijayawada, to please deliver his address and about him. Sri Hein Lagavin is Deputy Consul General at the Consulate General of the Kingdom of Netherlands at Bangalore since November 2018. He represents the Netherlands in South India. Hein joined the Dutch Ministry of Foreign Affairs in 2016 after graduating with a MA International Relations degree at the University of Groningen. He worked at the Netherlands Embassy at Suriname as a policy officer, economy and trade before joining the Bangalore office. Previously, he was active in Brussels at the European Parliament and the European Economic and Social Committee. We are really happy to have you, sir. May I now request Sri Hain to say a few words.
Thank you very much. Good evening. Thank you very much for the invitation extended to us for being here. I'm very grateful to be here, and I would like to extend how happy we are and how honored we are that the 8th annual World Hindu Economic Forum meeting will take place in the city of The Hague in the Netherlands later this year. The Hague is known as the International City of Peace and Justice, and it has a strong relationship with India. In November last year, the deputy mayor of The Hague visited Bengaluru and Hyderabad to renew a couple of MOUs, and one of the focus areas is technology. And I've understood that the topic of the 8th annual meet in The Hague will focus on sustainability, inclusiveness, and also technology. So once again, I'm very grateful to be here, very happy that the 8th annual meet will take place in the Netherlands, and I'm looking forward to the conference of tomorrow. Thank you very much.
May I now request all the elders and reputed guests to please release the souvenir, the brochure, World Hindu Economic Forum, Making Society Prosperous. I request all the dignitaries, Swamiji, Sri Suresh Garu, Sri Rajendra Prasad Garu, Gokaraj Gangaraj Garu, Sam Day Garu, Murali Krishna Garu, Andar Chetal Midga, Souvenir. World Hindu Economic Forum brochure released cheyabadindi, Making Society Prosperous. Next comes the main person behind all of these activities, Swami Vignanand Ji Garu. Varu, founder World Hindu Economic Forum. Mukhyanga aadhyatmika parangane kaakunda hindulane vaallu vyapara rangamlo kuda paiki raavali. Prapancha vyaptanga indaka manam oka audio visual presentation lo chusam GDP lo manam enta ముందుకున్నాము 35% దాకా. చాలా వరకు ప్రపంచంలో హిందూ దేశాల్లో హిందువులు ఉన్నారు. వీరందరూ కేవలం హిందువులుగా బ్రతికి ఆధ్యాత్మికంగా మాత్రమే కాకుండా వ్యాపార రంగంలో పైకి రావాలి, అభివృద్ధి చెందాలి అనేటువంటి ముఖ్యమైన ఉద్దేశంతో స్వామీజీ విజ్ఞానంజీ ఈ ఏర్పాటు చేశారు వరల్డ్ హిందూ ఫోరం అనే దాన్ని. ఇది చాలా 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 అవసరం ఇవాళ మన సామాజిక పరిస్థితుల్లో. వారు సుమారు 45 దేశాలు తిరిగారు, ప్రపంచం అంతా కూడా వ్యాప్తి చేశారు ఇది. సో ఐ నౌ రిక్వెస్ట్ శ్రీ శ్రీ స్వామి విజ్ఞానంద్ జీ టు డెలివర్ హిస్ అడ్రస్ అబౌట్ స్వామీజీ. స్వామి విజ్ఞానంద్ ఈజ్ అ బ్యాచులర్ ఆఫ్ టెక్నాలజీ గ్రాడ్యుయేట్ ఫ్రమ్ ఇండియన్ ఇన్స్టిట్యూట్ ఆఫ్ టెక్నాలజీ ఐఐటి ఖరగ్పూర్ భారత్. హీ లేటర్ స్టడీడ్ పాణిని గ్రామర్ అండ్ హిందూ ఫిలాసఫీ ఇన్ ఎ గురుకుల్. వరల్డ్ హిందూ ఫౌండేషన్ విచ్ హ్యాస్ 7 వర్టికల్స్ ఈజ్ హిస్ బ్రెయిన్ చైల్డ్. He motivates people to organize World Hindu Congress every 4 years and the World Hindu Economic Forum every year in different countries. Swamiji has traveled, as I said, almost in 45 countries. Every year He travels and he really, really inspires all of them. He is also a mentor to a number of similar initiatives to position, shape, strengthen and organize Hindu communities across the globe. I now request Swamiji to say a few words.
Conference will not be successful. And secondly, I thank the Honorable Minister, many known person, our Ganga Raju ji, and we were producing 35% of the world GDP. And Hindu of the world, we were producing 49% of the world GDP. And that is not my research. Again, connected to the him, he is related to that university. There was one person, Professor Angus Madison. He was Director General for OECD, and later he became professor in the Groningen University. He published two books, World Economy, Historical Statistics, The World Economy Millennial Perspective. And in that he presented data from 1st century till 1998. And in that data he is telling from 1st century, 15th century, we Hindu of the Bharat were producing 34 to 35% of the world GDP till 15th century. And across the world we were 49%. And after 15th century we have started declining. And after 1820 sharply declined, we became poor country. My question is here, if our society was producing such a big economy, there should be definite thought process, you know, there is a philosophy, there is understanding of the wealth creation. Because general impression is that ki we Hindus only do pranayama yoga, and we talk only about the moksha, you know, we don't talk about the economy. But this is totally wrong thing. My whole efforts in the last 10 years is to dispel this notion. Such a great country, such a great civilization, built such a big monuments and temples across the world in the Southeast Asian region. Without economy, they cannot build. You cannot build without money, you cannot build the Tirupati temple. Without money, you cannot build this Meenakshi temple. Without money, you cannot build Brihadeswar temple, Rameswaram temple. You can go in Parambanam or Angkor Wat. Without money, you cannot build. So our society was not just doing pranayama and yoga and bending backward and forward. They have also different economic thinking. So I will just give you some point. I will just give you another thing, because nowadays Ayodhya is in the news. How was Ayodhya of that time, which is mentioned in the Valmiki Ramayana? I will just give you few references so that you can understand the prospect of that city. Valmiki is writing in the Koshlo Nam Mudita Spito Janpado Mahan, I'm translating in English, extending along the bank of river Saryu, the world renowned city by the name of Ayodhya. Ayata Dascha Decha Yojnani Mahapuri. The great and glorious city of Ayodhya with well aligned road is 12 yojna, means 96 mile long, and 3 yojna, 24 mile wide. This is the expanse of the city. Rajmargena Mahata Savivaktena Sobhita. Ayodhya is graced with a beautifully ramified extensive highway, which is duly sprinkled with the water. Ramified highway with the divider. They have understanding of the dividing highway, you know. And you can see this, and daily sprinkled water, ramified highway. It appears that sometime we are in California, you know. California, they spray water daily on the road, sprinkler. Kapat Toran Varti Suvibhakta Narat Paranam. It has all well laid out market and is populated by all classes of craftsmen. You know, it is a prosperous and possess the matchless splendor is marked with the high raised building and flag. You know, high raised building, the multi-story building is mentioned. The people of Ayodhya city were happy, virtuous, learned, free from greed, truthful and content with their own fortune. They were not going and looting other one, you know. So this was Ayodhya. So I am just giving you just few reference so you can understand how our country and society was prosperous in those days. And this prosperity was not just coming only by doing yoga and pranayama, and doing katha and pravachan, sansar mithya hai. Is not coming. They have a complete and clear understanding what economy is. Therefore, World Economic Forum philosophy dharma se mulam artha. Economy is a strength. Without economy, nothing moves. So I will just give you some of the few things. Wealth creation is considered a very important duty in our society. It is part of a dharmic activity. Yudhishthira is said to Yudhishthira. Yudhishthira is said to the Krishna in Mahabharata. Yudhishthira, you know, said to Krishna. Dhanam mahu param dharmam dhane sarvam pratishritam. Wealth are said to constitute supreme dharma. Yudhishthira is telling to Krishna. Everything is established in the prosperity. Arjuna is telling to Yudhishthira. Artha is united with dharma and dharma is united with artha. Yo artho dharma ne sunyukta sa dharma cha artha sanyukta. Dharma artha are united together. Without this is nothing. Chanakya is even dharma shamulam artha. Again Chanakya is one place is telling. Artha eva pradhaniti kautilya. In my opinion, artha is very supreme, important. Without artha, nothing moves. In, you know, Hitopdesha we have heard the sloka. Vidya dadati vinyam vidya yatri patratam patratva dhanam apnoti dhanat dharmam tata sukham. You know, wealth result in dharma, then happiness. You know, empty stomach man, how he will be happy? Again, Bhishma is telling to Yudhishthira, there is no doubt dharma flow from the wealth. Even dharma flow from the wealth, you know. If you don't have money, you cannot do charity, you cannot do seva, you cannot do annadanam, huh? You cannot do this. Bhishma again said, dharma can only be served through the great wealth. Dharma can only be served through the great wealth. So you can understand how profound understanding they have. So I am just giving you just, so at least you will have understanding that our people were not just doing yoga, pranayama, ritual and puja. They have a clear understanding. Again, Arjuna said to Yudhishthira, dhana dharma pravardhate. Dhan se dharma badhata hai, no? Dharma thrives on the wealth, you know. Thrives on the wealth. You can see how other people are propagating their dharma in your neighborhood, huh? Because of money. That is not that they have a great philosophy in their literature and book and everything. Because they have a surplus wealth. That surplus wealth they are pumping in the west coast of your Andhra Pradesh. And another Santi Parva, Bhishma is telling, Arthe Sarve Samarambha. There is no doubt that all efforts depend on Artha and everything start from here. And very important thing, you know, see this is what management guru will tell you. Bhishma is telling, self-confidence and courage is the source of Artha. Self-confidence and courage is the source of Artha. A weak a person who is not have confidence, he cannot take risk, he cannot create wealth. Lakshmi herself is telling, you know, wealth, I dwell, you know, I dwell in a person who are competent and hardworking. I don't dwell in the lazy, aalsi log ghar mein nivas nahi karti hun. Na akarmani purushe vashami. Wealth does not dwell in the men who are not good in the deed and lazy. Aalsi log ghar mein, this is all Lakshmi herself is telling. Bhishma is telling to Yudhishthira about prosperous state, how a prosperous state is measured. People of the state should be healthy and not afflicted with a disease. First criteria is people should be healthy. When you have a prosperity, then you can fill your stomach, then you can have a nutrition and you will be healthy. Otherwise, you will not. Healthy and not afflicted with a disease. Second important part is tushta krishiwala, you know, farmer should be also happy and prosperous in your estate. If farmer are not happy and prosperous, then your estate is not prosperous, because farmer is the one who feed the society. And by importing food grain, you cannot be a sustainable and prosperous country. You all know there was a USSR, Union Soviet Socialist Republic. There was time they used to export food grain. But there was time they started importing food grain. And you know that they cannot feed by importing food grain to the 300 million population. And finally they collapse. They got disintegrated in 16 countries. Very important thing Narada is telling to Yudhishthira. A state should ensure that seed and food grain of the farmers should not get destroyed. A state should ensure that. Again, very important, agriculture should not be dependent on the rain water only. Narada is telling to Yudhishthira, big and large water tanks should be created in all the region of the state and should be full of water so that harvest is not destroyed because of lack of rainfall. You know, they have concept of those days to creating a big water tank, what is called talag, though the Sanskrit word is for talag. And very important thing mentioned in Kautilya's Shastra, the barren land fertile through toil of the farmer should not be acquired by the state. If farmer is doing hard work, he has created that land, it should not be acquired by the state. Farmer should have a full right over such a state. And very important thing about the loan, a state should grant loan generously to the farmer at the rate of 1% annually. 1% annually. There was a time when you go and buy a car, you will have a less interest. When you go and buy agriculture equipment, you will have a more interest. See, this is the understanding of our people. And after harvest, farmers should slowly return the loan to the state. This is also written. It's not that nowadays you take the loan and ask for waiver. That is also not there. Very clearly. If you generously loan them, minimum 1%. And after harvest, farmers should return the slowly, not at once. What is the strength of the strength? Very clearly they have mentioned. A state foundation is treasury and his army. These are the two strengths. And treasury is again the foundation of army. Without economy, army cannot sustain, you know. Because of economy at the moment is 2.61 trillion. We are only spending 1.5% of total GDP on the defense. I wish our economy should grow next 10-20 or 8-10%. For next 20 years continuously, so that we can spend more money on the defense, so that we can become stronger. Otherwise, China hame bullying nahi karega na. What is happening? China is trying to bullying us. No? When we will have economy, we will have our defense, they cannot bullying us. And about the taxation, very important about the prosperity, spreading the prosperity of the state, they had mentioned. Arjuna said to Yudhishthira, the rising ocean water is spread out in the all direction, you know. In that way, wealth inmates from the state spread throughout the state, you know. Because you collect the state, because Vyasa is telling, sun suck the water from the ocean and return back. But unfortunately, nowadays, state take the tax, but they don't return. That is happening. Again, Vyasa is telling to Yudhishthira, businessmen and farmers should be cared and protected by the state. Because in this world, in the globalized world, I am telling this is very applicable here. You cannot control talent, you cannot control capital, only you can attract. And for that attraction, you have to respect them, you have to honor them. A state should not disturb the day-to-day business and activity of the businessman. I will give you here a very important line. There is a discussion in Mahabharata when Brahma was crossing to Lanka. So people suggested we have a big army, we don't have a bridge. So the businessman has so many ships, so we take the businessman's ship and we cross the army. Rama told, no, we cannot do this, you know. We don't want to disturb the day-to-day activity of the businessman. That is the principle they have, you know. Another very important line in Sukriniti Shar. Satyacharastu dhanika bevhare hata yadi. Sometime honest businessman and farmer fell in distress. That time a state should help them to overcome the difficulty. Can you understand the clarity of these people? How taxation should be levied? Taxation is like extracting juice from the palmyra tree, palm tree, you know, the big tree. Therefore, never destroy the tree. Similarly, taxes should be collected from the citizen without harming them, without harming the danda lekar aajkal log ghumte hain na, waisa nahi karna chahiye. You know, income tax department and all the department has all the power. A state should examine the income and expenditure of the citizen, then only taxes should be levied, like draining juice from the palmyra tree. Loko chabyo drishtva vriksham Brihad Avashrastha. And how taxes should be imposed on the industrialists and businessmen, again in Mahabharata, Santi Parva, Bhishma is telling. Bikram Kredhvanam Bhaktam Sa Parichadam Yog Chemam Ta Samprache Vanidya Karet Karan. Estate must examine the sale and purchase, cost of the transportation, salary of the staff, and profit of the enterprise. Then only taxes should be imposed so that businessmen's survival is ensured. See the clarity of the people. Again, estate must examine the type of technology, cost of production, quality of product, and ensure that industries have a decent living also. And industry and industry flourishes, taxes should be consumerate. Sometime, you know, we have to give extra, you know, facility. Nowadays we give tax debate, and when businessmen go in a difficult area to do the business, for that also they have means, you know. Kaschitche banijo raste no dvanjandi karadita. Those businessmen tirelessly make efforts in a dissolute region in the state should not be afflicted with the heavy taxes. Otherwise they will leave the estate. Farmers would not be burdened by an overtax. Otherwise they will be oppressed. Otherwise they will leave the estate. Estate should take only 1/6 income as a tax from the citizen. This is in the Valmiki Ramayana. Only 1/6 of the income, not more. Otherwise you are forcing them to create black money. Yeah? And also very clearly, you know, now we talk about the capitalistic exploitation. In Mahabharata, Dhritarashtra said to Krishna very clearly that for a man, the destruction of prosperity is a worse calamity than the death. Destruction of prosperity is a worse calamity than the death. Prosperity is source of dharma and kama. E dhanad apkarzanti narah swabalmasra. Anyone who is power, claiming to be powerful, yani physically, mentally, intellectually, and exploiting others, and somehow accumulating other wealth and depriving others, for that they have. If a powerful person resort to one strength, exploit and rob a man of his wealth and destroy him along with dharma and kama, dharma, artha and kama too, the state should not allow this type of capitalistic exploitation and protect the citizen. This is all very clearly mentioned there. And so these are, I am just giving you the, you now you can understand ki our ancestor have a clear understanding of how the wealth is created, what we should do for wealth creation, how we should levy the taxes, how we should protect the businessman and farmer, you know. And therefore, we were creating big economy, not for one day, As per available data from 1st century to 15th century. 15th century till 1820, we were almost, 15th century onward when we have invasion, we have started declining. And even last 1820, we have a Bharat alone, we have almost like a 20% of the economy of the world. But finally we collapse. But now we are living in the modern time, we are all educated, qualified, talented, knowledgeable. So as a whole, as a country, as a society, we should focus on. Naren Bhai, again, he has mentioned again, think about the 5 trillion economy. How this will happen? This will not happen by one person, you know. For that, whole society, you know. Whole society means government, policy maker, bureaucracy, administration, judiciary, media, businessmen, academician. This world, because economy is again very, very important. What is happening right now? Total wealth, if you see, we are only less than the 3% of world GDP. And total average, if you distribute, each one is getting average, you know, 10 to 12,000 rupees per month. So our large still population is still poor, and only this will happen, only talking will not happen, you know. Just like, you know, I always tell, why many people ask me, why you have started World Hindu Economic Forum? Tell me, when my time is over, you tell me. Otherwise, I will keep on talking. One journalist asked me when we have a conference in Bangkok, why you have started the World Hindu Economic Forum? What is the basic difference between other economic forum and your economic forum? I told. There are economic forum based on the capitalistic model, you know. Capitalistic theory talk about the creation of wealth, generation of wealth, but they don't talk about the sharing of the wealth. They don't talk about the sharing of the wealth. And therefore, capitalist economy is also going to collapse. Because once wealth is accumulated in a small number of people, wealth is not distributed, finally their purchasing power of the people will no more. So again, the cycle will be reversing. Then there is another model, communistic model. They only talk about the distribution of wealth. They only talk about the distribution of wealth. They don't talk about the creation of wealth. यहाँ से ले लो यहाँ सब फ्री भी इधर से उधर टैक्सेशन कट फ्री भी देते रहो दैट इज ऑल्सो नॉट गोइंग टू वर्क अनलेस यू क्रिएट वेल्थ यू कैन डिस्ट्रीब्यूट एंड देयरफॉर वर्ल्ड हिंदू इकोनॉमिक फोरम इज मेकिंग सोसाइटी प्रॉस्पेरस क्रिएटिंग एंड शेयरिंग सरप्लस वेल्थ अवर मिशन इज क्रिएटिंग एंड शेयरिंग सरप्लस फर्स्ट क्रिएट वेल्थ देन शेयर एंड दिस इज नॉट माई वर्ड अगेन दिस इज नॉट माई वर्ड दिस ऑल्सो अगेन इन बेदा Veda say, this is the difference. I told him, look, the difference is our economic principle is based on dharma. What dharma say? Sata hasta samahara sahastra hasta sankira. Create wealth with 100 cents and share with 1,000 cents, you know. You remember, see the word. Create wealth with 100 cents and share with 1,000 cents. So this is our basic principle and this is what we have started. And we are not here to discriminate anybody, not here to dissociate anybody, everybody is welcome. With that spirit comes, we are working with everybody. Our idea is we are across the world, we are larger population. Now our population is talented, qualified, knowledgeable, connected, and successful. So we are only putting, let's focus on the next 30, 40 year, we should focus on the wealth creation. Then we can look after our society. Otherwise, we cannot look after the society, you know. Education minister here, you know, there was time we have here university like Nalanda, Taxila, Ballavi, all the international industry here. People used to come here for a study. What is happening now? Annually, 1 lakh, 2 lakh students are going outside for higher study. 2 lakh students going for higher study. And the amount is like annually 30 to 40 billion you are spending money. The Marshall report, you know, Raghunath Marshall report is 20 year old. And what he mentioned, if we save that money, we can build 20 to 30 IIT annually here and 30 to 40 IIM annually here in this country. But we have not utilized our own resources to build our talents, you know. So create wealth and look after the interest of the society, educate them, make them successful, make them powerful, and make them country successful. Progress and look up the interest. This is the whole purpose of the World Hindu Economics, so that we can live in this world with a dignity and respect. Namaste.
Thank you, Swamiji, for your inspirational words. Mana maro visishta atithi Sri Mallikarjun Rao Mallampally garini saviyaniga vedimidiki aahvanistunnanu. Sri Mallikarjun Rao garu is a former senior executive Commonwealth Educational Media Center for Asia. I call upon Sri C. Rajendra Prasad garu, CEO Continental Coffee, to deliver his speech. Sri Challa Rajendra Prasad garu is a member of Coffee Board of India, executive chairman at CCL Products India Limited, and a member at Andhra Pradesh State Financial Corporation. He is on the board of directors at Aries Habitat Private Limited, Continental Coffee Private Limited, Grand Sovereign SA, Jayanti PTE Limited, Carafe Private Limited, and NGON Coffee Corporation Limited. Mr. Prasad was previously employed as a founder, president, and chief financial officer by Mutual Funds Leader Incorporation, a managing director by Asian Coffee, and a chairman by Konasima Gas Power Limited.
Good evening, friends. I don't know what all she read. I am not sure whether frankly, this is the first time I am knowing something about this economic Hindu Economic Forum. Thanks to Garapati Prasad Garu. So when he sent me this invitation, first I asked, what is this about? So when I heard Hindu, so I thought I should be here. So I'm not a great speaker, but what just now Swamiji said is 100% true. And India, you know, we are into exports of coffee. We export coffee, instant coffee, to 80 countries in the world. Initially, when first time our coffee was exported in the year 1990 to USA and to Europe, first people did not believe that there was instant coffee coming from India. The first container, which had 290 boxes, every box was opened and sniffer dogs were sent in, because this instant coffee can easily, you know, hide the drugs, which the Colombians do. So every box was opened, and finally it was proved that we were only doing 100% exports of instant coffee. Today, thanks to God and thanks to our country, after 1986 only, our personal experience in international marketing, because India started shining. Today, every foreign country consumer wants to come and visit India. Again, this is the strength. See, I've been talking to all these, most of these, you know, foreign companies, telling them India is one of the richest countries in the world. They used to laugh at me. Now they have recognized, now they know what is our strength. So I'm sure the Hindu Economic Forum, see, we have a plant in Switzerland. We are the only listed company who is having an instant coffee, you see, conversion company in Switzerland. When the Swiss were invited us, we were really scared. Why the Swiss guys were inviting us? Then we had a Swiss collaborator at that point of time, and he said, okay, why not we go and start an industry? So we again started a factory in one of the smallest villages in Switzerland. And similarly, the Vietnamese invited us to put up instant coffee in their country, because we were importing a lot of green coffee from Vietnam to India. So they realized that what I was doing, I was bringing the coffee to Thugirala, a small village, and we were producing instant coffee, we were exporting, and we were doing value addition. The same thing they wanted us to repeat in that country, we did it. So today, it's very easy to sell our country. We need not sell our country at all anymore. Earlier, 20, 25 years back, it was so, but now, I'm sure with the guidance, whatever just now Swamiji mentioned, see, we can be as collectively, we can achieve wonders. We can definitely be a $5 trillion company, country, than whatever these people have been talking that it is not possible. It is possible. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity.
Thank you, sir. May I now request Dr. Mallikarjun Rao Mallampally garu to say a few words. Vari Gurinchi, he is a former senior executive, Common Health Educational Media Center for Asia. Dr. Mallikarjun Rao garu served the Commonwealth of Learning, Canada, Commonwealth Educational Media Center for Asia, and worked 30 years in Osmania University. He is a doctorate in ancient Indian culture, history, and archaeology, and MBA. He is working on Ramayana and Mahabharata as textbooks of ancient Indian economy. As chairman of Social and Cultural Research Institution for Intercontinental Exchange, he coordinates research in various countries across the world in the area.
World Hindu Economic Federation Economic Forum today asked me to dwell upon some ancient techniques of on economic front of Hindu society. Yes, we have two great scholars in this country who had recorded with evidences about the Hindu society's multiple angles, whether it is military strategies or diplomatic relations or global expansion of the economy of Bharat or social structure of the country, Bharat, or sciences developed in our country. In many angles, they have recorded. Those two great personalities are Valmiki and Vyasa. Valmiki has composed 24,000 verses of Ramayana. And in that Valmiki Ramayana, generally people believe that he taught about bhakti of Rama or made Rama as a god, and Parayana of Ramayana is good for our both spiritual and mental health, but it is not so. It may be in 24,000 shlokas of Ramayana, every shloka gives one or other aspect of military science. Nowadays, how many science branches are available in the world? That many science branches are included in each and every shloka. 24,000 references of different sciences, different social and cultural aspects, and to your surprise, 195 countries are there now in India, in the world, and almost all major countries were referred in Ramayana. You take it to America, Russia, Germany, Netherlands, all these countries were mentioned in Ramayana with those times name. That times, Ramayana time, what name was there to that country? It is mentioned. And who was ruling that? And how they participated in Ramayana war? Ramayana war is a global war. Three races were living at that time, broadly. Even human geographists, they say, entire world community is divided into three races. Black race, yellow race, pink race. Black race, you all know that, Africa, Australian aborigines, and in many other countries of black people origin, that is black race spread throughout the world. In the same way, yellow race, Southeast Asia, entire Southeast Asia, China, Japan, Korea, all these countries are yellow race. In Ramayana, they were called Hari. Hari means yellow. Hari means Vanara. Hari means monkey. Haris, they are called. Haris are led by Sugriva and before that Vali. So entire Southeast Asian countries, they were ruled by Sugriva. Entire black race was ruled by Ravana. Ravana's birthplace is not Bharat. He's from African origin. Black race, black man, Rakshasa. And Rama's birthplace is Ayodhya, comprising Asia and Europe. He was ruling at that time. So global war it was, and to that global war, people were drawn by Sugriva from different yellow race countries, by Ravana, all the countries, taking even from very far places of America, the Rakshasa communities. They were called Danavas, Asuras, Rakshasas, varieties of clans, Gandharvas, Yakshas, all these part and parcel of Rakshasa community, Broadway. So these people, they came. So this way, It was a global war. So leaving about that war strategies and war economies, we will come to the economic front of Ramayana. Any economic front, basic thing what we need is counting system. The counting system 1, 10, 100 and all this. Nowadays, European counting system ends with 18 zeros after 1. That is the maximum counting system in the European counting system. Whereas Ramayana gives, at that time, the money is counted with 1 after 74 zeros. This is the evidence I will give you. When Ravana asks Sukha and Sarana, two spies, to go and verify how much the army strength of, what is the army strength of Rama, then they go and return. Then they tell their master Ravana, oh Ravana, please listen. Before we tell the number of soldiers with Rama, you must know their counting system. Why? Ravana does not know that counting system of Rama? Yes. Nowadays, we have European counting system is different and Indian counting system is different. Am I right? European counting system is millions, billions, trillions, quadrillions, quintillions. Quintillions is the last. And Indian counting system is, in 28th chapter of Yuddha Kanda, this is given by Valmiki, Shata Sahasrena, Shata Sahasranam Kotir Mohur Manishinaha, Shatam Koti Sahasranam Shankurityabhidhiyate, Shatam Shankhu Sahasranam Mahashankuriti Smrutaha. As this way, he had given 8 shlokas. The meaning is, wise men call 100 lakhs as a crore. In the Indian system, it is crore. Whereas in the European system, Europeans cannot understand what is crore, what is lakh. Their counting system is different. Millions and 10 millions and 100 millions and trillion, 10 trillion, 100 trillion and quadrillion and quintillion. That way, their counting system. This was there with Ravana also. Ravana was following the European counting system at that time of Ramayana. Whereas Rama's counting system is our Hindu counting system that goes with 100,000 Shankhus is called Mahashankhu, 100,000 Mahashankhus are called Vrindam, and Padmam, Mahapadmam, Kharvam, Mahakharvam, and Samudram, and Augha and Mahaugha. Mahauga means 74 zeros after 1. What for this counting is needed? Does anybody has got that much wealth? It is not for wealth counting. It is the counting for one planet to another planet in the sky. And from sun to another sun, how to reach, what is the distance between? That means our numerical system at Ramayana time is that great. That so far, even now, the European systems have not reached that level. That was the affluence of Ramayana period. Our sciences, mathematics is the first basic science. That mathematics, we have got that much knowledge at the time of Ramayana. This is clearly mentioned in Yuddha Kanda, 28th chapter of Yuddha Kanda. So this way, and the socio-economic system is very, very important for economic development of the country, of the world. Can any country nowadays challenge, can they provide 100% employment to their citizens? Any country, including America or Russia or Netherlands or any country, can they provide 100% employment to the citizens of that country? Absolutely, it is no. Because in every country, unemployment problem is there. But during the period of Ramayana, there is no unemployment. 100% employment was there. This is mentioned by Rama curtailing the freedom of the people in economic front. How? This continued in this country from Ramayana period to Mahabharata period and until 400 years back. In this country, in Bharat, every family is an industrial family. You go to a village 400 years back or 200 years back or 100 years back, every family has got some family industry. Teli wala tel chalata hai, oil extracting persons, that family, or wood carpenter's family, goldsmith's family. Every family is attributed with some industry in his house. Cottage industry, let it be, or big industry. You tell me one family without industry in a village. And in that family, young persons, they will do hard work. Ladies, they supporting work. And children, they learn from the 50 year onwards. And old people, lighter work they will do in their house. So, entire family has got a job opportunity, earning capacity. This is the Hindu economic system. Every family has got, every family and all the members of the family, they got wealth creation capacity. This wealth creation capacity in nowadays societies, even the countries, they are forgetting. They are giving employment only to the educated youth or women or men. Retirement, after retirement, no income. But in the Indian society, in the Bharat society, even if there is no retirement, first of all, until the date of death, the person, the old person, he is contributing something to the profession of his house. So he is earning every day. In the same way, after 5 years, child, he is contributing whatever little he can do in the father's profession. And he is becoming expert within a span of 10 years time without going to any school, college or university. In the house itself, he is becoming a professional, skilled person. So this way, the economy, socio-economic system of the Ramayana period continued in this country until last 200-300 years back. This country changed its economic system. After British came, they changed this economic system, the ancient economic system. This way, only one aspect, even if I take, even one science, it takes hours together. In one place, I am giving for the last 3 years continuous lectures on Ramayana, each shloka. Each shloka gives, every shloka, it is not dharma related, it is artha related. Every shloka is artha related, every shloka is kama related. Kama in the sense of desires. With our wealth, what we do? We fulfill our desires. And how to create wealth and how to earn wealth? It is through dharma. That is righteous way we have to create and acquire wealth. Unrighteous way, if we create and possess wealth, we know the fate, what happens at the end. He will go to the jail or he will go to the other way. So this way, very beginning in our society, Ramayana is the basis and continued until Mahabharata time and continued until the British changed our economic, military, all systems, education. Our education system was great. Every word in the education system is described in Ramayana. Doctorate. What is the meaning of doctorate? Yes. So all this is education system itself will take at least 5 hours. Entire education terminology is in Sanskrit. Doctorate, matriculation, graduate, even curriculum is gurukulam. This way, syllabus is shala abhyasa. This way, every word in education system, economic systems, all that what we are pronouncing in English, they are all given in Sanskrit in Ramayana. All these references are there. Every country, about every country, it is there. Their histories of the countries. So with this, There are many points about the economic systems to tell before you, but the time limitation is there, 15 minutes. Whereas if it is 5 hours, easily we can mention all those. But only for 15 minutes, I limit myself with the instructions of the organizers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. As we all know, all these are in our scriptures. And I now request Pujya Swami Vijnananji for the launching of the Hindu Economic Forum Vijayawada chapter.
I just have to invite our team here on the dais so that we can have a photo. Murali Krishnaji is here only on the dais, our president. SRK Prasad, vice president, is where he is now? There. And Bhaskar Rao ji, general secretary, I saw him there. And Sudhakar Chaudhary is here. Please come, at least we'll have a photo with all together. Kumar, please
thank you, Swamiji. Sri Gokaraj Gangaraj Garni, former MP and Chairman Laila Group, Luptanga Matladavalsindiga Kortunanu. Sri Gangaraj Gar Gurinchi. Sri Gokaraj Gangaraj Garu is a renowned politician and a member of parliament to the 16th Lok Sabha from Narsapuram Lok Sabha constituency, Andhra Pradesh. He won the Indian general election 2014, being a Bharatiya Janata Party candidate. He is also the founder of Laila Group of Companies and recently was elected as Vice President to the Board of Control for Cricket in India, BCCI, South Zone. He is also the Secretary of Andhra Cricket Association, Chairman of Financial Committee of BCCI and also the Member of Governing Council of Indian Premier League. I now request Sri Gangaraj Garu to say a few words.
Good evening, respected Swamiji Vijayananji, the dignitaries on the dais and off the dais. I will not take much of your time. We have been listening to the past glory. We have to think about the present, where we are and how we are going to move forward. This is very, very important because our economy is almost at the bottom level and each and everybody has to contribute their might to rise up to that extent that, you know, we are on par with other countries also. It is very essential that, you know, we know why India is lacking. The main reason is that we do not have enough research facilities to invent newer things. The government doesn't fund for research unless we find something new. It is not going to be, it will not help us getting into rat race, copying others, what others do, and try to move forward. If you were to do research and produce a product and patent it, you will have almost more than 100% profit. If you copy somebody and make it, you have to depend on 2 to 3% profit. So it is very essential that the country and also the industry has to move towards research and find newer things. You know how China is progressing. They produce everything for the entire world according to their requirements. For India, they know, for Diwali, you need crackers. They export crackers. For Holi, they supply us colors to play with. And for gifts, they supply. So they cater to the requirements of the world, different countries. That's how they are coming up. Not that they do research in all areas. Most of the areas, they copy others. They teach steel technology and they produce in bulk and make it very, very cheap, and that is how they are growing. I don't suggest that we should do that, but we have to do research, and because we got the talent, our youth are highly talented and they are doing wonders outside India. And they should come back and help us to build India to higher levels. I'll take only a few minutes. It's very, very essential that, you know, all of us has to work very, very hard and concentrate, be honest, and do quality production and do something good so that, you know, you sustain for a longer period. I started my business in a very small way. I passed through hard days. And when I had an opportunity, I have grabbed it and I've been doing very well. Today I'm into herbal business, I'm into Ayurvedic business. Ayurveda, you know, it's a very ancient science, but you know, I have modernized Ayurveda to compete in the world market. Ayurveda did not have any testing facilities. I have developed testing facilities. And I'm introducing to the international market, and the worldwide I'm able to export. And we have our own research center. We do research for ourselves in our particular area, and we patent worldwide, and we make very good profit because the patent is valid for almost 20 years. So that is how in each and every area we have to do research. And I request the corporates to cooperate and pass on some of their funds, you know, to the percent or 2% they are supposed to spend for other activities. So they should pass it on to our Hindu Forum to form a very strong research center where, you know, different areas we can develop and pass it on to the youngsters to move forward. It is very, very essential that one has to have honesty and hard work. That is the only way that you will prosper. At one stage I was zero, but I never gave up, and I worked very hard, sacrificed all my comforts, and I was going by bus, right from car to the bus, walking also, there was no problem. We have not cheated anybody. Whatever money we have borrowed, we paid them back, and then we have done well today. By the grace of God, I am in such a position that in one area, I am one of the leading businessmen as far as that herbal business is concerned in this country. So with these words, I will not take much of your time. I congratulate Swamiji for introducing the chapter in Vijayawada, and you know, for Andhra and Telangana. I am sure all Hindus will help other fellow Hindus to prosper so that the entire Hindu community will come up, and it is very essential. We have seen so many communities, we have seen Chinese, we have seen, you know, Germans and others, you know, who are in very, very bad condition, how they have risen. And same way, Indian, we being Indians also, it is high time that we come up and then, you know, be also on par with any of the our neighboring countries. With these words, I congratulate the newly elected, you know, team of people. I'm sure they are very, very dynamic. Murali Krishna is there, another friends are there. With their cooperation, I'm sure we'll try to, you know, advise the youngsters, but also if they can approach us for their requirements, and definitely we will do our best to give them advice, because we pass through very, very difficult days, and I'm sure with their dynamic leadership, I'm sure the chapter is going to do wonderful. With these words, I thank each and one of you for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Now we'll have a 1 minute video on World Hindu Economic Forum 2020 held at Netherlands. It's a Hague conference.
My name is Nienke van der Malen. I'm the director of the Hague Partners. Today, I've been given a privilege and honor to cordially invite you to The Hague, the Netherlands in 2020, where we will be welcoming the World Hindu Economic Forum. The event will take place in the famous World Forum, a venue where international leaders convene and make impactful decisions. The Netherlands are a business destination, proclaimed by Forbes as one of the best countries for business. Holland's strategic location at Europe's front door provides the perfect springboard into the European markets. Together with access to talents, cutting-edge research and innovations in the field of science, technology, engineering, agriculture, waste and water management, strategic locations at Europe's front door provides the perfect springboard into the European markets. Together with access to talents, cutting-edge research and innovations in the field of science, technology, engineering, agriculture, waste and water management, strategic locations at Europe's front door provides springboard into the European markets. Together with access to talents, cutting-edge research and innovations in the field of science. Door provides the perfect springboard into the European markets. Together with access to talents, cutting edge.
Are you playing? Or shall I continue? It's okay, we'll put it later. Swamiji said to put later. He is a seasoned professional with North America, APAC, Europe and Middle East. I request him to say a few words of thanks.
Namaskar. Take this opportunity to thank Swamiji. Hello. I take this opportunity to thank Swamiji for giving this vision of opening our Hindu Economic Forum in Vijayawada and also between Andhra and Telangana. And we also want to just to share our thoughts in a one-liner, where what we have learned from Hindu Economic Forum, from our ancient history, is to how to create wealth, and also how do we distribute the wealth to the people. So this is one thing I felt that Hindu Economic Forum will teach all of us who are all big business people over here. So we need to take that message away from here, that we have to learn creating the wealth and also distributing that wealth to spread to the entire fraternity of the world, and then specifically to the Hindu population. So with that, I wanted to thank the entire HEF team, the team from Delhi, who has facilitated for conducting this process of launching this in Vijayawada. And I also sincerely thank Sri S.N. Kumar Garu, who is spearheading with his direction in getting this launch successfully, along with his team. Sri Bhaskar Rao Garu, who is the Andhra Pradesh Chamber of Commerce General Secretary, and also now the General Secretary of the chapter of Vijayawada, and his team, who have helped in inviting a lot of businesses from within Andhra. I also want to thank Sridhar Babu Garu, who is Swadeshi Jagann Manch, who spent his time continuously for almost more than a week to 10 days in inviting all the businesses in Guntoru district along with his team, and brought in the awareness and also the lot of participation here. I thank Kamal Narayan Bangji from Vijayawada, who has also contributed extensively in creating the awareness and then bringing participation from various businesses. MLC PVN Madhav Garu, who has with his all the extensive political turmoil which is happening, he could able to spend time in bringing businesses to participate and then got in the awareness. Sri Piyush Desai Ji, and similarly Sri Bhaiya Srinivasulu Garu, who has reached out to the businesses in Nellore specifically and then brought in a good amount of